We'll take that as a yes. Welcome to our walking tour and trivia of campus history. My name is Sarah Wells, and I am the Director of Impact Giving. I hope you all have been enjoying the virtual Alumni Weekend 2021, and congratulations to all of you who are celebrating milestone reunions. Today, we're going to take a virtual tour of some of the most historic buildings on campus, including the Edwin A. Stevens Hall and the Carnegie Lab. We'll also travel back in time to see Castle Stevens, the elegant former home of the Stevens family. Our expert guides are Leah Loscutoff and Ted Houghtaling, our leading archivist from the Samuel C. Williams Library. Leah and Ted preserve the university's collection of artifacts featuring precious heirlooms from the Stevens family, the papers of Frederick Winslow Taylor, and the John Lee Memorial Collection of Leonardo da Vinci, and so much more. Leah and Ted will take us on a tour, and then we'll test our knowledge with some of Stevens trivia. We'll be using the program Kahoot, and we'll explain later how this works for trivia. In the meantime, if you have any questions, please feel free to add them to the chat box. Now, please welcome Leah and Ted.
Thank you so much, Sarah. Hello and welcome, everyone. I hope you're all having a great virtual alumni weekend so far. So we're going to take a quick historical virtual tour through the lens of some of the most iconic landmarks on campus and take a sneak peek into some events and memories from the past. Next slide, Ken. As most of you already know, when Edwin A. Stevens passed away in 1868, he left in his will a bequest to establish an institution of higher learning and left $150,000 for an initial building to be constructed and $500,000 for an endowment. The image to the left displays the site of the EIS building before construction started, also known as the administration building or the A building prior to 1987 when the building was dedicated to Edwin A. Stevens. I just reread Edwin's will this week to see exactly what he stated in his last wishes. And he does specify the lot of land as that block of land in Hoboken, bounded by Hudson Street, River Street, and 5th and 6th. Then the will specifies that a building will be erected in a suitable style for the uses of an institution of learning within 3 years after he is deceased. The architect selected to design this first campus building was Richard Upjohn, a British-born architect, most famous for his Gothic architecture and Trinity Church in Lower Manhattan. Martha Bayard Stevens and her brother Samuel really did an amazing job of honoring Edwin's request, since Stevens first officially opened 3 years after he passed away, just as he wanted. The doors opened on September 20th, 1871 to 21 students. Next slide. So here are some great early images of EAS. When the college courses started in 1871, weekly public lectures were also held in the evening in the large lecture hall, and the general public was admitted with purchase tickets. The lectures were divided into two subjects, popular and technical, and were a great opportunity for the new staff to connect with the local community. Also, the very first commencement ceremonies were also held in EAS. The one and only building on campus until Carnegie Laboratory was constructed in 1902. The early commencement ceremonies were often reported on by the New York Times, and digging through the New York Times historical database, I found one article from 1875 that mentioned that about 1,000 people attended the Stevens graduation ceremony, including the governor of New Jersey at the time, Joseph Bedell. The number of students graduating in those early graduating classes were usually about like 10 students, and they would each read a portion of their senior thesis as part of the commencement exercises. A few senior thesis titles from those very early years include design for a 50-ton floating derrick, design for a turbine water wheel to work under a fall, review of pumping engines, and artificial flight. Next slide, please. Some important events happened at EAS in the early days, such as the very first meeting of the American Society of Mechanical Engineering, or ASME. That first meeting happened at the large lecture hall on April 7, 1880. The very first president of ASME was also Stevens Mechanical Engineering Professor Robert Thurston, who was inspirational in professionalizing and implementing standards in the field of mechanical engineering. In addition, a small room on the western side of EAS, on the first floor, was set aside to house the school's first library. Much of the collection consisted of contemporary engineering and industrial arts journals, textbooks, serials, and patent literature. A much smaller collection of literature, history, and philosophy texts were donated by individual faculty and administrative staff that reflected the philosophy of the school's first president, Dr. Henry Morton, and his desire to create a well-rounded engineer with a broad academic foundation. I do believe that that is also Morton in the lecture hall right there. In 1907, a professional librarian was hired, Miss Enid May Hawkins, and her expertise greatly improved the library collection and space. Also in 1907, incandescent lights were installed throughout the campus, previously illuminated by gas lamps. So after that happened, the library was then able to extend its hours into the evening. And we believe this image here reflects the library in the 1890s when gas lamps were still being used. And the library moved to the Lee Building in 1918. Next slide, please. This next photo depicts a play that was performed by Stevens students in 1930 at what was then the Stevens Theater, now DeBon, called Control, a Pageant of Engineering Progress, written by George P. Spaker of Yale University and Stevens Humanity Professor and eventually the director of the research of sound at Stevens and Stevens Theater director, Harold Burris Meyer. This play was performed in honor of the 50th anniversary of ASME, which began in this very same location and was a celebration of the progress mechanical engineering had made in the last 50 years. The New York Times reported on this historic event, and the writer describes it here. Yesterday, more than 500 eminent engineers from all parts of the United States and many foreign delegates gathered in the same room to see the scene of the original meeting reenacted in a pageant which formed the climax of festivities of the first day of the society's anniversary. Next slide, please. And now Ted will talk about Carnegie Laboratory.
Hey there, everyone. Good to see you all and happy Alumni Weekend. So I'm gonna briefly talk about the Carnegie Laboratory of Engineering. So a good place to start is with its namesake. Andrew Carnegie was one of the most influential figures in American history. He greatly expanded the steel industry in this country and transformed communities around the world with his philanthropic work late in life. But perhaps lesser known is his deep connection with Stevens and his subsequent growth. So we'll start in 1891 when, after a long courtship started by our first president, Dr. Henry Morton, the Stevens Board of Trustees voted unanimously to elect Carnegie to their ranks, which was a major coup for the young school in terms of prestige and the fundraising potential. So later on that decade, Carnegie attended Stevens's 25th anniversary festivities at the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in Manhattan. And later that year, President Morton wrote to Carnegie expressing his desire to expand the footprint of Stevens, which was already starting to outgrow the crowded confines of Edwin A. Stevens Hall, which, you know, most of the offices and lecture halls and academic research centers were all housed in that one building at the time. So Carnegie invited Morton to stay the week at his castle in Scotland and afterwards pledged to fund the first new building for Stevens since 1870. In a letter dated May 20th, 1899, Carnegie said, quote, "It would give me the very greatest pleasure to devote $50,000 to the building of the engineering laboratory as you suggest." He went on to say, "My business and industry as a whole owes much to Stevens for the many valuable men that have come to us from it," end quote. So after Carnegie increased the building fund to $65,000, construction was ready to begin. The proposed three-story building was designed by the architecture firm Ackerman and Ross, who designed a number of Carnegie-funded libraries throughout the United States. And Ackerman himself, interestingly enough, was a graduate of Stevens, Stevens class of 1891. So the basement and first floors were devoted primarily to the course in experimental mechanics, along with smaller equipment for testing the strength of materials and calibrating instruments. And the largest engine seen here in the top middle supplied power to the machine shops and was donated by members of the Stevens family. The top floor had two large lecture rooms with full-sized machines, which could be operated and studied by the entire class to illustrate and provide hands-on experience with these specific principles of mechanical engineering, which was far better and more modern than what they had in Edwin A. Stevens at the time. President Morton also donated an additional $15,000 of his own money for the construction of a boiler house, which adjoined the laboratory and supplied it with steam power. Construction wrapped up in early 1902, and the dedication of the new Carnegie Laboratory of Engineering, as it was named, was held on February 6. During the evening presentation, President Morton presented to Carnegie a section of the first T-rail, which was originally designed by Robert L. Stevens, brother to our school's founder, Edwin A. Stevens. The T-rail was housed in this ceremonial silver casket designed by Tiffany and Company, seen here on the right. And it had four carved figures on the exterior depicting the history of industry. So the one on the left that you see was a prehistoric blacksmith of the Iron Age. The one on the right represented a graduate of Stevens Institute. On the other side, you would have seen an armorer of the Middle Ages, along with a village blacksmith from the Industrial Age. And on the front in high relief, you can see an image of the John Bull steam-powered engine, which ran on the Camden and Amboy line in the 1830s, which is one of the first railroads in the US. So after the presentation, the meeting adjourned to a large lecture room on the top floor, which was transformed into this lavish banquet hall. The 300 attendees would have seen a series of unique and interesting engineering constructions for the food and drink display, which were designed and executed by President Morton himself. The table spread included a large model of a blast furnace with working gears, which produced punch. And there were trays of food carried on these little miniature trains that traveled around the room. And on another table was a model of an open hearth furnace that was lit with red electric lights so that when the counterweighted door was raised, the furnace gave the impression of glowing embers heating the display of fried oysters. So it was a pretty lavish affair. Carnegie, whose generosity made the laboratory possible, was of course the guest of honor. And according to an account in the Indicator, quote, he seemed greatly pleased with the warm reception. And upon receiving the first glass of punch from the blast furnace, called for and led in giving three hearty cheers for the genius of the Stevens family and President Morton. And it was well-deserved. Although Carnegie donated the funds, the new building was really the vision of Morton, who throughout his life at Stevens was constantly petitioning for the school's expansion, even giving money out of his own pockets to see that vision realized. But sadly, a mere 3 months after the lab was dedicated, Morton passed away due to a lingering illness, and Alexander Humphreys became president of Stevens in 1902. And we have a letter here in the middle written by Carnegie to Humphreys, offering his condolences. And even after Morton's death, Carnegie maintained his ties to Stevens and donated an additional $150,000 to the endowment fund and continued to serve on the Board of Trustees until his death in 1919. And all total, Carnegie's gifts to Stevens amounted to $717,000, which helped plant the seeds for further growth on campus. So now I'm gonna pass it back to Leah.
All right, thank you, Ted. So we're gonna get into the Castle Stevens now. The Castle Stevens was the home of the Stevens family. And when Colonel John Stevens first purchased this land, it was in 1784. right after the Revolutionary War. He purchased the land of Hoboken for $90,000. It was on auction from the US government. Colonel John Stevens was a great engineer and naval architect of the 19th century, treasurer of New Jersey during the active period of the Revolutionary War. And he was also known as treasurer on horseback because he would often be found with a big treasure chest of money, which we actually have in the Mary Stevens room, on the back of his horse. He labored throughout his entire life for the application of steamboat navigation and railroad locomotion. Also just the Stevens family in general, we're not gonna get super in depth with them right now, but they're one of the most productive engineering and inventor families of the 19th century, I would say. Next slide, please. The Stevens family established their estate on a bold promontory known as Castle Point, overlooking the Hudson River in New York City. The original residence of the Stevens family was known as the Stevens Villa, a 20-room house built by Colonel John Stevens shortly after he purchased the land of Hoboken for $90,000. The painting to the right is the only image we have of the Stevens Villa, and it was painted by Hudson River Valley painter Jasper Cropsby. After the Stevens Villa burned down, a new home named Castle Stevens was built. Castle Stevens started construction in 1854 under the direction of Robert L. Stevens. He's the son of Colonel John, but he died before it was completed. Although architect Alexander Jackson Davis was initially consulted on the castle construction, the credited architect was Thomas R. Jackson, an otherwise obscure New York architect who worked with Richard Upjohn, who was also the architect for the Edwin A. Stevens building. Next slide. Many photographs of the house survive, as well as records of life in the castle. Many of the items that were once on display in the castle are now on display at the Samuel C. Williams Library. The Mary Stuart Stevens Baird Room on the first floor was dedicated to the granddaughter of Edwin and Martha. And she was born and raised in Castle Stevens. She donated many paintings, artifacts, and furniture pieces to Stevens before passing away in 1989. Next slide, please. Also, a shameless plug for the Historical Preservation Committee. Recently, we used funds donated to the Historical Preservation Committee and were able to conserve this painting of Edwin A. Stevens, a portrait that was once on display at the Castle Stevens. Look at that amazing difference. Actually, Ted, can you go back one more slide real quick? You can see that painting would have been displayed around there in the rotunda of the castle. It looks like the same one. So we do have that at the Samuel C. Williams Library, now conserved. Next slide, please. The Stevens family members lived on Castle Point until 1910 in the Castle Stevens, when they then sold the land and property to Stevens so the campus could expand as needed. I love these images of the Stevens family living at the castle and going about their personal family activities and kids playing on the old Revolutionary War era cannon and horseback riding on the estate. These images mainly depict Edwin and Martha's children and grandchildren in the late 1890s to the early 19 teens. I often think about how the family lived at Castle Point back then when I'm walking around campus. It might look drastically different, but I think the spirit of the Stevens family is definitely still there. Next slide, please. The Stevens family were well connected politically and socially, and many famous historical figures visited the family, including General George McClellan, former governor of New Jersey, President Woodrow Wilson, as this image to the left depicts, and P.T. Barnum. The first ever open air performance of Shakespeare's play, As You Like It, was performed on the lawn of the castle with Maurice Barrymore playing a lead role on June 16th, 1891. Agnes Booth, a member of the famous theatrical Booth family through marriage and sister-in-law of Edwin Booth and John Wilkes Booth, was also included in this performance. This photo on the right is a recent discovery in the archives. We had never had any identification of these photos in the Stevens family papers, but after more inspection of them, we were able to conclude that this is definitely Maurice Barrymore and Agnes Booth to the right. So it must have been in 1891 in Castle Stevens when the Shakespeare play was performed. When Woodrow Wilson visited Stevens in 1913, the castle was already owned by Stevens Institute of Technology and being used as administrative offices and dormitories. Next, Ted will discuss more on the castle when it was a big part of campus life.
Okay, so after the Stevens family sold the castle property to the Institute in 1910, it quickly became a fixture of campus activity for generations of Stevens students. And aside from the fraternity houses, it provided the first and, for a time, the only dormitories on campus. It also played host to class dinners, initiations into students, social club gatherings, and balls and dances like the junior prom photo seen here. Along with the administrative offices housed there, it became for many the heartbeat and soul for life at Stevens. But a few decades later, there was already talk of replacing it with a larger, more modern structure. In 1936, President Harvey Davis proposed a bold new expansion project, which would have radically reshaped the look of the Stevens campus. Part of this project entailed knocking down a few of the older buildings that, in Davis's words, had, quote, outlived their usefulness. And at the top of that list was Castle Stevens. And we're talking the mid-1930s here. So as you can see from the picture on the left, it wasn't surprising that he would want this building replaced. Regardless of the sentimental value to the school, the building was in constant need of interior and exterior repair. And so the prohibitive cost of maintenance for this nearly 100-year-old building made its demolition, in the administration's mind, a no-brainer. And as you can see in the design proposal here on the right, the plan apparently also called for tearing down Edwin A. Stevens Hall. So it had it gone through, it would have been a pretty radical transformation. Luckily, the administration was able to go forward with building two new dormitories, Jacobus and Palmer Hall in 1937, without resorting to knocking down Castle Stevens and the other historic buildings on campus. But for the next few decades, the physical state of the castle did not improve. And again, it was on the chopping block. In the early 1950s, the Alumni Association rallied support from thousands of concerned alumni and members of the Stevens family to raise over $100,000 for a comprehensive restoration project, which was just in time to celebrate the castle's 100th anniversary in 1954. The new unveiling and anniversary was commemorated during convocation on November 10th, 1954. Professor Humphrey from the Humanities Department delivered a lecture on the history of the Stevens family, and a plaque was dedicated later that evening to commemorate the historic occasion, which you can see here on the left. And from the left to the right, that's President Jess Davis, who had recently assumed office in 1951. Colonel Basil Stevens and Mary Stevens Baird, the grandson and the granddaughter of Edwin A. Stevens. And on the right, that's Archibald S. Alexander, the great grandson of Edwin, who was elected the state treasurer of New Jersey that year. But shortly after, a new administration under President Jess Davis, just like the previous administration, began a new campus development plan, starting with the construction of a new science and engineering building in 1955, which was later rededicated as Bouchard in 1959. And that project entailed tearing down Recitation Hall in 1954. Hayden Hall, a new dormitory, was built in 1956, And so the next phase of this plan called for the creation of a new library, additional classroom and laboratory facilities, and as the centerpiece for the plan, a new student administrative center to replace the aging Castle Stevens. Yet again, the fate of the castle was up in the air. And even though the castle had been partially restored a few years earlier, President Davis maintained that it was still, like it was in the 1930s, a simple matter of mounting maintenance costs and the fact that Stevens really had no more room to grow at a time when it was experiencing a significant increase to its research output, student enrollment, and additions to faculty and staff. Sounds kind of familiar. So the administration and Board of Trustees finally agreed to move forward with their plan, which was announced in the fall of 1958 with the demolition of the castle slated for early 1959. But after the announcement, a flurry of opposition spread among the alumni under the rallying cry of Save the Castle. Among them was William Nordling, president of the Alumni Association, who joined with members of the Stevens family, including future New Jersey Congresswoman Millicent Fenwick, to help preserve the castle on the grounds of its deep historic connection to the school and the city of Hoboken. A group of alumni also formed an organization called the Alumni Group Urging Preservation of the Castle, who sent a mailer to thousands of members of the Stevens community to gauge their opinion concerning the castle's fate and to promote its preservation, which you can see here in the bottom left. And it soon became a hotly debated topic, not just in the pages of the Stute or in the Indicator, but in most of the major New Jersey newspapers. You know, even the New York Times covered the controversy. One letter to the editor of the Jersey Journal even said that if Stevens tore down the castle, it would, quote, break the last lone direct connection with its past, end quote. Adding to the chorus of protest was an official resolution adopted by the legislature of the state of New Jersey, along with letters of protest from cultural heritage organizations like the National Trust for Historic Preservation and the New Jersey Historical Society, among others. So as you can probably tell, passions were running pretty high. It wasn't just a matter of tearing down a building to make way for the future. Unfortunately, you don't really have time to get into the weeds of the pros and cons of progress and preservation. But if you're interested, I'd recommend you all check out a great documentary on the history of the castle that was done by John Dalton and Richard Reeves of the class of 1960, which gets more into this history. So that's available on the archives website, library.stevens.edu/archives. So that's definitely worth checking out. Needless to say, the forces of progress won out, and the over 150-year-old Castle Stevens was torn down to make way for the new 14-story, 65,000 square foot Stevens Center, which officially opened in 1962 and was later rededicated as the Wesley J. Howe Center in 1996. The 1960 issue of The Link dedicated a section to the castle, which I think really sums up the whole event pretty accurately. It says, quote, "In the end, in the engineer's mind, facts must rule. And the facts, the economic realities, held sway and dictated that the proud past must yield for the sake of the prouder future. We felt then that the castle should be preserved, but that this preservation must be in the minds and hearts of Stutesmen, for a memory is often more pleasant than cold, hard facts," end quote. So here we are today. For some, the castle is a cherished, powerful, but you know, increasingly distant memory. And for others, it's just an interesting piece of Stevens' history. So on the note of remembering, we thought we could take a moment to briefly acknowledge some of the other buildings that are no longer with us, but perhaps for some of you, play just as an important role in your lives and the history of Stevens. So we're gonna take a little brief stroll down memory lane and revisit some of these sites from our past. So that about does it for our portion. Thanks everybody for listening. Apologies for the sentimentality at the end there. And I guess now we're gonna hand it over to Thomas for the trivia portion of this afternoon.
Sure, I noticed we have some questions in the chat. Did you wanna address those now or did you wanna address them after trivia?
We can address them now since they're in reference to the talk, I'm sure.
Perfect, so let me read them to you. So is that the same cannon that is currently on the terrace facing the Hudson, or is the current a replica?
No, that's the same cannon. It was excavated in 1883 under property the Stevens family owned near Lake Elysian Park, where that is now. They owned a hotel over there called the Colonnade. And when they sold that land and they were doing some excavation work, they uncovered that cannon. And it's actually been at Castle Point ever since 1883. So back when the Stevens family used to live there, they used to, you know, play on it.
Wow. The next question, does John Stevens' great grandkid still connect to the campus?
Oh yeah, there's a lot of Stevens family descendants. We hosted, actually before I started at Stevens, I started at Stevens in 2013, but in 2012, they hosted a family reunion and about, I feel like over 300 people went, and they keep in contact with the descendants. Probably down the road, we'll host another reunion at some point. I don't know when that would be, but yeah, there's definitely a connection with a lot of the descendants. A lot, you know, they live all over the world now, as you can imagine.
And Michael Cahill shared, Sam Reckford, who serves on the Board of Trustees, is a descendant of Edwin and Martha Stevens.
Yes, he is. He is the grandson of Millicent Fenwick, who was the granddaughter of Edwin and Martha. So he's a direct descendant from them.
And the question, what dorm replaced Hayden Hall?
The new university center. Stay tuned.
Yes, stay tuned for that. So I think those are all the questions in the chat. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen now for Kahoot. I'm also going to type in the chat box the Kahoot code.
While Thomas is doing that, there is one other question. Wasn't Davis Hall a ship at some point?
Was Davis Hall a ship? Mm-hmm. The question?
Yeah.
I don't believe so. The only ship is SS Stevens that was used as toys for a brief time. Ted, have you ever heard anything like that? I don't believe that's, yeah.
Maybe it was the South Dorm, is what Jeff Katz says.
Mm-hmm. Davis was called the North Dorm, wasn't it?
And the South Dorm was maybe the ship?
Oh, you know, but the North Dorm, I thought, was renamed to Humphreys. Am I correct on that?
That's correct.
Yeah.
I thought it was Palmer was the North Hall, but I could be wrong.
No, North Dorm was Humphreys.
Yeah, which was, Palmer was actually the first official dormitory building that was just set aside for residence halls on campus. And they constructed that in 1937, same with Jacobus.
So on your phone, on a mobile device or on a computer, if you go to Kahoot, Kahoot.it, and click enter. There's no .com or anything like that. It is .it. It'll prompt you to type in this code 2308373, and then go ahead and type in your name, or some people are putting their initials or their class year. Feel free to put however you want to be identified on here. Just know that if you do use a nickname and you do end up winning, you will need to let us know just so we can get you your prize at the end. So I'll give everybody another minute or two to keep going, to keep logging in. Right now we have 17 people and we have over 70 on the call. So I'll give everybody a minute or two more to log in. And if you don't want to play along or you're not interested, feel free to just sit in the chat. If you have any questions, Leah and Ted can answer those. But we're looking for prizes today.
How do we get to Kahoot?
If you go to open a web browser, either on your mobile device or on a computer, and type in www.kahoot.it and click enter, it'll prompt you to enter this code, the game PIN.
All right, could you repeat the code?
Yeah, it's 230-8373.
You can find the information in the chat as well. All right, so it looks like we've been steady at 45 participants, or 46 right now. I'll go ahead and do one last call. Is anybody having any difficulty and you want us to wait for you, or should we go ahead and get started? All right, so with that, I will stop our allowing people into it, and then we will now get started. So Ted and Leah, the floor is yours.
All right. So I guess we'll start with question number one. Why is the Stevens yearbook named The Link? Is it a reference to mechanical engineering? Is it because its first editor's last name was Link? Is it because it linked its two predecessors, or is it a play on Link to the Past? So I guess the counter will go down. You'll have 30 seconds to answer, and then we'll move on to the next screen. And yes, the name comes from the linking of its two predecessors, the Bolt and the Eccentric, which were two rival yearbooks who agreed to consolidate in 1890 to form the Link, the current yearbook for the Stevens community. The earliest yearbooks at Stevens date back to 1880, and all are preserved right here in the archives and special collections. All right, next question.
All right, which person has not received a Stevens honorary degree? Prince Charles, Marlon Brando, Herbert C. Hoover, or Frank Sinatra? Remember, you only have 30 seconds and it's going down. So yeah, Marlon Brando, I have to say when he filmed on the waterfront in Hoboken, he did take a tour of Stevens, and some Stevens students actually were extras.
Five, six. Okay,
is anybody there?
And then I put
75 people.
Thomas, if you go to the next slide, I just put some images of people that have received an honorary degree. I think a lot of people don't realize that Prince Charles received an honorary degree in 1977. A lot of people know about Frank Sinatra, maybe not Hoover. We don't have any photos of Hoover receiving an honorary degree. It actually happened at an alumni dinner, I believe in 1954. But Prince Charles also has a very distant relation to the Stevens family, apparently, as well.
All right, question number three. What was the last year Stevens awarded the degree of, actually it should be awarded the degree of mechanical engineer? Is it 1971, 1945, 1958, or 1969? Okay, Frank Roberto is moving up the ranks. The answer is 1958. From the school's founding in 1870, Stevens only offered a single broad-based curriculum to its students, which led to the degree of mechanical engineer. But in response to the country's need for trained scientists in the post-World War II era, Stevens created the Unified Science Curriculum in 1959, which was a four-year program in mathematics and the physical sciences, leading to a Bachelor of Science degree. The educational philosophy behind the school's original curriculum stayed in place, but now students have the option of pursuing either a Bachelor of Engineering or a Bachelor of Science. So next question.
All right, what other famous artist besides Alexander Calder is also an early graduate of Stevens? Eugene Vail, William Merritt Chase, Jasper Cropsey, or George Bellows? So it was Eugene Vail. He graduated from Stevens in 1876. He's a really well-known artist. He has work in the Smithsonian American Art Museum, Brooklyn Museum, and also the National Gallery. He, like Alexander Calder, didn't really do much engineering after he graduated. He ended up kind of just going into art. So it's kind of interesting.
Okay, what year did the student council discontinue the tradition of requiring freshmen to wear class dinks, otherwise known as beanie hats? Is it 1971, 1967, 1969, or 1974? And I reckon a lot of you in the crowd probably remember wearing these dinks, so.
Do you still have them?
Yeah, we actually have a couple in the archives, so
yeah,
safely preserved for posterity. And yes, the answer is 1969. According to our records, the tradition of incoming first year students wearing class dinks goes back to 1931. It was later discontinued in 1969 in favor of class jerseys, like the one you see here. And as far as we can tell, that tradition lasted well into the 1980s. Now first year students have new traditions like the duck dance and the whip pen walk, amongst others. But if you wanna know more about the history of Stevens tradition, Leah and I presented a two-part lecture last year on the topic, which you can view on the Library Archives website. So please. Next question.
All right, true or false, did Stevens ever have an organized cheering squad?
All
Yes, true. Early cheerleading in general at universities kind of started around 1880s, but Stevens had a cheer squad as early as early 1900s to the teens, but then they kind of disappeared for a bit during the 20s. They revived it in the 30s, but it disappeared altogether in 1936. But there's one quote in the student I found that I thought was kind of funny in a way. Someone was talking about the cheer squad at Stevens, and they said, cheering has always been a weak point, and the cheerleaders seem ashamed of their job. So it's like they're kind of debating whether or not they should keep it or not. So it didn't last past 1936, unfortunately. Those are great uniforms.
Okay, so we know that the Gamma chapter of Theta Z was the first national fraternity established at Stevens back in 1874. But what was the first official sorority chapter? Is it the Gamma Epsilon chapter of Delta Phi Epsilon? Is it the Gamma Chi chapter of Theta Phi Alpha? Zeta Mu chapter of Kappa Alpha Theta? Or is it the Delta Theta chapter of Phi Sigma Sigma? Yes, the answer is the Delta Zeta chapter of Phi Sigma Sigma, which was established on campus on February 27th, 1982. And just a brief little history, women were admitted to Stevens in 1971. And shortly thereafter, there were these so-called little sister groups that were associated with the fraternities. But later in 1977, a group of women formed the local sorority Zeta Omega. So they were technically the first sorority, but the Phi Sigma Sigma chapter was the first to be nationally recognized at Stevens in 1982.
All right. Which of the following public figures did not visit Stevens between 1967 and 1968? Jackie Wilson, Gerald Ford, Muhammad Ali, or Timothy Leary? Yeah, so Jackie Wilson did not perform at Stevens. Timothy Leary did, Muhammad Ali came, Gerald Ford. So we had a lot of pretty amazing guests during that time period. But Jackie Wilson was actually supposed to perform at Stevens in 1967. He just happened to get flu and have to cancel the last minute. I'm a big Jackie Wilson fan, so I was excited to get him supposed to come. And also, if anyone out there saw any of the other people, would love to hear from you, because I haven't really heard anyone. A lot of people went to attend Timothy Leary, Gerald Ford, Muhammad Ali, but I haven't really heard anyone talk about those visits or anything like that. So I'd be curious.
Yeah, not a lot of photo documentation too. So if you're sitting on any photos of these visits, please share them with the archives. Okay. Which of the following cited Frederick Winslow Taylor's writings on scientific management as an influence on their work? Taylor was a member of the class of 1883. And is it Henry Ford, Louis Brandeis, Vladimir Lenin, or all of the above? The answer, of course, is all of the above. Taylor is perhaps best known, or is perhaps one of the more famous and influential graduates of Stevens. He pioneered the idea that engineering concepts of standardization and efficiency could be applied to manual labor and replace rules of thumb with accurate measurements. His theory of scientific management was a huge influence in its day and continues to have a far-reaching impact on labor and industry in this country and around the world. And I'll also note that we're pretty fortunate to have the Frederick Winslow Taylor collection housed here in the library archives, because it's definitely one of our most used collections. Researchers around the world make use of this collection. And it consists of his personal and work-related correspondence. There's photographs documenting scientific management in factories. There's other articles, essays, and ephemera related to his wife. And a good portion of it has been digitized. So you can all view it from the comfort of your home by going to the Library Archives homepage. So maybe we can drop a link to that in the chat if you want to check that out. All right.
All right. Which scientist spent 40 minutes staring at a Calder mobile at his first MoMA exhibit in 1930? Nikola Tesla, Niels Bohr, Irving Langmuir, Albert Einstein. Majority of you got the answer, Albert Einstein. It's a famous story that he was recorded as spending 40 minutes, at least 40 minutes, staring at a Calder mobile at his very first exhibition at the New York Museum of Modern Art. There's also an exhibit going on right now on Calder's work. So I'm gonna try to check it out myself. It's there till August 7th, and it's called Modern from the Start. Also from just going back to some of the answers I selected, Irving Langmuir won the Nobel Prize for Chemistry in 1932, and he does have a Stevens connection. He actually was a faculty member at Stevens in the early days, like around 19-teens and stuff. So we do have some materials, not a lot because he wasn't there for that long, on Irving Langmuir as well. All right, in the year that Stevens was officially established, 1870, which of the following events also took place that same year? The incandescent light bulb was first patented by Thomas Edison, North America's first transcontinental railroad was completed, Standard Oil was established, or the Tootsie Roll candy was invented? So yes, Standard Oil was established in 1870, but some of those other ones happened, you know, almost around the same time. Incandescent light bulb was, I believe, 1877. Tootsie Roll was 1880s. Also, Hoboken is known for the Tootsie Roll factory. So I wanted to put that one in there. And then the Transcontinental Railroad was probably maybe soon after that, like a year later.
I think this is the last question, so this is worth double points. When the library moved out of the Lee Building in 1969, what research facility took its place? Was it the Plastics Research Center? Was it the Laboratory of Psychological Studies, the Laboratory of Powder Metallurgy, or the Cryogenics Center? Double points. Answer is the Cryogenic Center, and yes, we had a Cryogenic Center. The library moved to its present location in the Samuel C. Williams Library in 1969, and the Lee Building became the home to the Cryogenic Center, which was maintained by the Department of Physics and Metallurgy. It served as a research laboratory to study the effects of sub-zero temperatures on various materials. So who won?
So before we announce, before Kahoot announces the winners, I just wanted to share what was in the chat for Leah and Ted. So sure. Robert Eddie said he remembers the visit in the lecture by Muhammad Ali. So Robert and Leah, we can definitely connect you two.
Great.
If you want to learn more about that. Kenneth Sullivan said the cannon was absent from Castle Point for several hours when it was moved to New York City in 1967 or 68 by members of the class of 71 and changed to a light post using a borrowed buildings and grounds truck.
It was put on the PATH system also and sent to New York.
And Jeff Katz said, a constant game of cat and mouse between the students and Bob Mahan, the director of buildings and grounds at the time.
We have just another plug. If you go to the Voices of Castle Point oral history project, I have the oral history clip of Jerry Crispin and Ed Eichhorn, who stole the cannon twice, I believe, during their time at Stevens. And it's really funny because they do like the whole, you know, step-by-step accounts, and the way they tell it is really humorous and great.
Also, Glenn Babcock, Leah, I can get you connected with him too. He said, Muhammad Ali had the audience in the palm of his hand. He was really on that evening. Oh, so wow. There are some people on the call who did go to those events who can definitely get you guys connected.
That's great. Thank you so much.
So now for the drum roll, Kahoot will now go ahead and announce who the winners are.
Congratulations, Frank. Yes.
Hey, class of 71.
Hey.
And runners up, we have Michael, Cahill, and Robert at the end. So Stan H, whoever CH3 is, and Frank Roberto, please go ahead and drop your name in the chat, and we're going to, Ed Yao will go ahead and contact you guys after for your prizes.
So thank you, Leah and Ted, for speaking today and for all you do year round to preserve the university's proud history. And thank you, Thomas, for running Kahoot for us. And thank you everyone again for attending. We hope you've learned a few things that make you feel an even stronger connection to your alma mater. Please enjoy reconnecting with your classmates and have a great virtual alumni weekend. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you for organizing this. It was great.
Have a good night.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.